I've done.
Oh, you mean you haven't hit the I want 3,428 M&Ms, but none of them can be green?
Right. Yes.
The infamous Van Halen request. And when we come back, we might like to talk a little bit about, because I know that Student Activities does do a couple of major shows every year, and some of the things that go into getting those pulled together, because I know for all of you, that becomes real hair-pulling time of, wait a minute, we've got to bring these people in, we've got, then you get the entourage and everything else involved. So at that point, we kind of go through some of the things necessary to stage a major act, and we'll be back with more of VSU Voice right after this.
In America, you are not required to offer food to the hungry or shelter to the homeless. There is no ordinance forcing you to visit the lonely. In fact, nowhere in the Constitution does it say you have to provide anything for anybody. Thank you for all you've given. Imagine what more could do.
Time to teach a new way.
The power to wake up young minds. Teachers have that power. Reach for it. I'm Edward James Olmos, and we're recruiting new teachers. For information, call 1-800-45-TEACH.
Welcome back to VSU Voice. And of course, every year, Student Activities, last year, for example, now my memory's going to fail me. We had Tim McGraw and Faith Hill. Yes, very good. Country fan, aren't you, Robin? And the Collective Soul concert that was here as well. Robin, I know that this is part of where your life becomes rather chaotic and hectic. Between you and Russ, I know on concert day you tend to be running around like heads with your chickens cut off. In the process, what does it take to be able to stage a major show as opposed to a smaller band that might be regional in nature?
Again, Russ can probably tell you, he handles the details of the contracts and that kind of stuff. Tara plays a big part in it on when those days come. She's responsible for getting, because she's in charge of concert and dance, responsible for getting our security and our ticket takers and all those kinds of things. My responsibility usually on that day is, so far has been tickets and ticket sales. And each artist has their own rider, and a rider usually consists of what food they will eat, what food they will not eat, towels, those type of needs. That is my responsibility, and then Russ's, I guess, is more jack of all trades that day.
Well, for example, I know that staging gets much more complex and involved. What does it take to transform the PE complex into a concert venue?
Cooperation from everybody on campus. We have a concert task force that I chair, and we work with public safety, plant operations, the athletic department, the academic departments there in, in the PE complex. And we pretty much let them know what's coming and what to expect. And even the day of the show, it takes all of our students and all of our staff to pull it off.
How do you get the staging in there? Is plant ops responsible for building the staging?
Well, we have our staging. It's pretty much a stage we use at graduation. But we were fortunate about 12 years ago to have purchased Seco staging, which is the standard concert staging. So we can have a 56 wide, 30 feet deep stage, and that's about as big as we can go. Now, we have rented staging from Albany before, and probably won't do it again, but we had a very large stage for Tim McGraw and Faith Hill.
Right, okay. Once the contract is signed, and obviously contracts and the negotiating of contracts gets quite complex and detailed, and if you don't have six lawyers looking over your shoulder, you're almost afraid to take pen to the dotted line. But What are some of the more unusual requests that, you guys have fielded from some of the major acts? Well, the ones you can talk about on TV.
some are towels. I know Robin's been, I got to have a white towel. I can't have yellow, green, or whatever. I've got to have a white towel.
78 white towels.
Yeah, a certain number
78
of towels.
78 white towels. Not 79, not 77.
We have a lot of groups request alcohol. We don't do that.
Right.
We don't purchase alcohol. We tell them, if you want to go do that, we'll point them in the right direction, but that's up to them.
Right.
We bring in furniture sometimes, some rent furniture from our furniture stores. They've got to have so many mirrors, some of them in their dressing rooms. But the contracts, like you said, sometimes it'd be 10 pages and 120 pages.
Yeah.
The sound and lights a lot of times come with the show, but we do contract a lot from Real Rock Productions in Tallahassee, who are very experienced and have done it for a number of years for us.
Right. So basically, they will serve as kind of a liaison for you with the professional sound crew that travels with the tour or whatever. What's the involvement? I know that usually you try to get the stage in the day before the show. How much is involved that day in setup and trying to get the band up and on stage?
That day is pretty much nonstop. Well, the stage and floor and the complex in general will be ready the night before. We'll have loading somewhere between 6 and 8 usually for any show, larger shows the earlier, and how many semi-trucks they bring them. And we are nonstop until probably 3 or 4 the next morning. Our students do a great job. They get little pay, but they do a great job.
Tara, for a concert of the size of Tim McGraw and Faith Hill, or more recently, the Red Akin show, how do you go about finding security people? Go grab all of Hal's offensive and defensive linemen, or?
I did do that a couple of them. Go grab a couple of them. A lot of my friends have come to me that were interested. A lot of other students, when we're out at our campus activities events, you know, I talk to them and explain to them what goes in there. There's not a lot of pay in it, and it's a lot of labor. And you have to understand that it is work. You're not going to be, you know, back there socializing with the artist the whole time. It's not all fun and games and glamour. It is hard work. And we were there from like 7:30 that morning until about 3 o'clock the next morning, basically. So it is a lot of work, and I was for the most part pleased with all of my guys. They did a great job. And
what are some of the responsibilities for the security people? And especially, I guess, thinking back to concerts like Collective Soul, where sometimes you have in the rock arena, mosh pits still still are popular. Stage diving sometimes gets out of hand. How do you work with security and the band in order to try to keep everything under control and not have 17 people with broken legs because they were slam dancing?
Well, the main thing, we brief them before we go in the show, explain to them exactly where they each have a position, and they're to stay in their position and not to run around and not to just, you know, stay at the stage, because, you know, we can only have a few around the stage. I was not directly involved with Collective Soul since I just started this summer, but I know for Red Akins, the crowd there was not quite as bad. The crowd was really good until the end. But the guys, the audience can come up and take pictures, you know, and they have to direct them back to their seats, and they can't just let all the girls come flock up there just so they can get close to Red and just generally keep crowd control. But I was really pleased with the crowd for Red Akins.
Do you spend any time, do they go through any kind of a training session with, for example, Scott Donner with Public Safety, or one of his people on some elements of crowd control, or do you guys take them through a brief workshop on methods and techniques of acceptable? Obviously, arm twisting is not a good idea.
No, not for the little 14-year-old girls at the Red Akins. But we gave them a quick briefing before, and there was a guy there that was head of security, and he's been doing it, and so he, you know, told especially the guys that were around the stage what was expected of them and what to do in certain situations. So that was really good. So we didn't have any real problems at all.
There. their security, and if there's a situation, they know there's a line that's public safety or police, and that's their job, and not not the student's job
to worry with and to try to fight. Now, with John, I know you were there for the Collective Soul show. What differences do you have? And sometimes, obviously, in the rock arena, the artists are not exactly cooperative with your desires for security as well.
I knew when someone my size got caught behind the front line that we need to, we need to step it up a bit. But the artists want to make sure that that everybody has a good time, and we want to make sure that nobody gets hurt. And sometimes those kind of can butt heads, and so we just try to kind of find the median line there, and with somebody stage diving, you just try to get them down off of there before somebody drops them on their head,
right?
And and get them out of the way, basically, was the experience I had with it. But it was it was, Tara said, it was a lot different from Collective Soul than Red Acres.
Right. Well, and I've noticed over the years that country audiences do tend to be somewhat more restrained in enthusiasm for the artist.
Yeah. Cheers, just good enough. You take that. You know that when you bring the artist in, that it's a different crowd, but you can't not cater to that crowd just because of that. You've got to there again, we touch on the diversity issue. Mm-hmm. You've got to bring something in for everyone.
Right. So it's a matter of trying to match as much as you can to all of the choices and all of the desires.
Close your eyes and hope for the best.
I hear that. We've been talking today about the impact of enrollment and some of the things that student activity fees fund. This has been VSU Voice. Thanks for joining us, and be sure to join us next time. Until then, I'm Michael Taylor.
Check that I got what you ordered.